Good afternoon. It's good to have everyone here as we've come together to remember and celebrate a life well lived and a life well loved, the life of Alan Niquette. It's a blessing to have a part in his celebration of life as he had such an impact on my life, and I know he has on each one of you here. That's why we're all gathered this afternoon. I'd like to open us in prayer, and then I will read an autobiography or a biography of his life. Would you bow with me? Father, we thank you for Alan's life. We thank you for the many lives that he touched. Lord, we thank you for, most of all, the assurance that he is with you because of Jesus, his Savior. God, thank you for the difference, the dramatic difference that Jesus made in Alan's life. And thank you that through him, you made a dramatic difference in so many other lives. God, we are surprised, I think, to be honest, in some ways, that he has gone home, from our perspective, fairly soon, fairly early, before we would have anticipated. But God, we're happy for him. We know that Alan is doing great. He is enjoying seeing you face to face, Lord Jesus, worshiping you, and we are so grateful for that. And we are grateful for the legacy he leaves behind. We pray, Father, that that legacy would continue as the seeds he's planted continue to bear fruit. And we pray that you would be honored as we honor him today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Dr. Alan, the drama guy, Niquette, 71, of Independence, Oregon, died October 30th, 2014, peacefully in the early morning. He was born in Riverside, California on April 17, 1943, to Ray and Margie Niquette, the third of four children. Alan grew up in Longview, graduating from Brethren High School. He received a Bachelor of Arts in Humanities from Biola University, La Mirada, California, in 1967. He then received a Master of Divinity from Talbot Theological Seminary, La Mirada, California, in 1972, followed by a Doctor of Ministry from Western Conservative Baptist Seminary, Portland, Oregon, in 1987. Alan received his Certificate of Ordination from Valley Bible Church of Northridge, California, in 1976, where he and his brother David co-pastored. Alan went on to serve local churches for more than 20 years in full-time pastoral ministries that emphasized expository preaching and teaching. By the way, when I first met Alan, I'd heard that he had a doctorate, and I think I addressed him as Dr. Niquette, and he told me, don't ever do that. Never do that again. He didn't want to be known by something that distanced him from people. In 1981, Alan met and married the love of his life, Beth, on May 14, 1983, and together they raised three children. In 1990, God called Alan to use his gifts to serve local churches by presenting creative programs that were Bible-centered, appealing, and life-changing. Dramatic Difference Ministries Incorporated was born on October 24, 1991. And so that was just 23 years and 1 week before Alan's homegoing. And it became a full-time ministry available to serve local churches in the United States. Alan based his ministry on the deep conviction from the Bible that the Bible is the very word of God, the final authority for all Christians believe and do. With this background, Alan committed his life to a Bible teaching ministry that was clear and practical, that instructed young disciples while enriching the lives of mature believers. It was a ministry that moved all ages toward an authentic, growing relationship with God and his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Alan's infectious enthusiasm and passion for life touched the hearts of everyone he met. He was a great encourager and blessed countless lives wherever he went. Alan was known for his sense of humor, and he kept people laughing both on and off the stage. And I'm sure later in our time today we'll hear some examples of that. He was everybody's best friend. Theater was not just his work, it was his delight. His love for the Bible was evident in all of his stage plays, and you could hear his desire for others to know God in his voice when he performed. Alan also loved music and would spend nights sitting around playing bluegrass music with his family on the guitar, ukulele, bass fiddle, harmonica, and gut bucket. I don't remember if I ever saw him play the gut bucket. I do remember one time when we went to the coast together that we did that. We stayed up and they all sang and Alan played the guitar. Cooking was one of his love languages, and he made wonderful daddy tacos, onion rings, and chip dip. Every time he'd go over, he wanted to serve those. He was also an adventurer and loved hiking, biking, canoeing, and train chasing with his family in the middle of the night. He was a great man of prayer, and he prayed for everyone he loved at any hour of the day or night. One of the most beautiful things about Alan was his determination to say, "I love you," to his family every single day of his life, which he did without fail. Survivors include his wife, Beth, children, Jenny, Kinney, and Stetson, and siblings, Paul, Patricia, and David Niquette, and countless, many more family and friends. One of Alan's greatest goals was to live his life in such a way that when he finally met with his Savior face to face, he would be told, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master." And we are confident that these words have been spoken. That is so true. Amen? Amen. When Beth asked me to read the biography of Alan's life, she said that she'd like for me to share a few of my memories as well. And you will all have the opportunity to share memories later on during our time. We'll have an open mic for you to share testimonies of Alan's life. So maybe this will kind of set the stage for that later on. I've had the privilege of being mentored by all three of my predecessors as pastor teacher at our home church of Bethel in Almsville, the other Bethel, even though I know you've changed your name here. But all three of them have mentored me through the years. And Alan was the one who had the impact on my life when I was approaching marriage. God used him to prepare me for married life. I met Alan and Beth right around the time my wife, Lisa, and I started dating. And that was a formative time for me, and their example was huge in my life. Alan was candidating at our church at Bethel, and during a Q&A time, he was asked about his approach to marriage and to family life. And he said this, "My desire before the Lord is to provide loving leadership for my wife, and her desire is to have a respectful response to me. And as we both live in those roles, our desire together is to honor Christ by reflecting his love for the church and the church's response to him." And that example became the theme for my marriage, for Lissa's and my marriage, because it came at just the right time. Alan was also an example and an encourager for me in ministry, as he was, I'm sure, to many here. They started Dramatic Difference Ministries 23 years ago, and it grew following their time with us at Bethel. And as they began that ministry, their first drama, many of you probably remember this, was Abraham and Sarah. He makes me laugh. And I've always pictured Alan and Beth being like Abraham and Sarah, because they were starting out on a journey to a promised land or a ministry that they didn't know what was ahead. They didn't know what it would look like, just like the characters that they were playing in that first drama. And their faithfulness and God's faithfulness to them has been such an example and encouraged me to pursue ministry as well. Now Alan has completed that journey. He is in the promised land. Amen? He is with the Lord in heaven. And I know he has heard those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." We will see him again. And his legacy lives on in the many lives around the Northwest and probably even throughout the world that he has touched. Alan has truly made a dramatic difference. Amen? Amen. Well, during his ministry with Dramatic Difference, Alan had what he called a V-team. And I've forgotten, Beth, what does V-team stand for?
Volunteer team.
Volunteer team. Okay, that makes sense. Volunteer team. I'd forgotten what it stood for. And so he would draw people who were supporters from different churches who would come with him and go to other areas to perform. And we had several from our church family who were part of that through the years. And one of those is going to sing for us today, and that's Matthew Edwards. He went up to Washington when Alan was performing there at Joint Base Lewis-McChord, right? And has been with him on the road. And so he's got a song for us that really epitomizes what Jesus has done and what Alan is experiencing and what we have to look forward to, because Jesus is alive.
The gates and doors are barred and all the windows fast down. I spent the night in sleeplessness, rose at every sound. Half in hopeless sorrow, half in fear of the day. Would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. Before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle, and the voice began to call. So I hurried to the window, looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches, and the sound of soldiers' feet. But there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me as she told me where she'd been. She said they moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. So we all ran toward the garden, and John ran on ahead. Found the stone and the empty tomb just the way the memory said. But the whining sheep they'd wrapped him in was just an empty. There, but just what I didn't know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him. I saw him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I promised him added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. Suddenly the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume.
I'll tell you a quick little story. I really want to reserve my remarks a little later on after we have heard from you. But I believe there's a blessing God wants me to pass on to you, and I feel the sense of His presence as I say this. When I heard that Alan was in the process of being attended to by the wonderful, wonderful paramedics and those that gave attention to him, I got that word, and I'm trapped in Colorado, but I'm not too far away from heaven. And I went and sat down with my cup of coffee, and I just started to say, boy, I've helped a lot of other families through these kinds of times. I've been in ministry as long as Alan was, 46 years. And now it's my turn. It's my brother, my flesh and blood. I sat there and began to plead with the Lord and said, Lord, would you heal? Would you? I couldn't even get the words out. Something put a check in my heart, and I realized I hadn't consulted with the Lord what I should pray. You know, the Bible says that we don't know what to pray sometimes as we ought, but the Spirit in us prays with groanings too deep for utterance. And I gave way to that inner, deeper groaning, and I started saying, Lord, don't let him suffer. And peace came to my heart, and it was as if that prayer was irrelevant. And so I finally settled down and said, I'm not going to go through the checklist of what all good Christians should pray at times like this. Lord, teach me. Tell me what I should pray. And I found myself forming the words, Lord, pour out your grace there. And he poured it out here. And I believe I had an encounter with the Lord in which he directly indicated he's home. And I got up with peace. My heart was on him, and I was absolutely convinced. And it wasn't until 40 minutes later that I heard that, in fact, Patricia, our sister, said the words, he's gone. And yeah, a little bit of a punch in the solar plexus, but let me tell you, the peace was already there. That's what we have as a takeaway. I don't want to say this at the end of the service. You need it right now. Would you just bow your heads and open your hearts and lift your spiritual eyes to him? And perhaps just in this moment, all you who know Jesus Christ, know his voice, the voice of the shepherd, the comforter. And you can just simply look into the face of God and receive a gift from his hand. And it's the gift of peace. In the name of Jesus, Father, I ask that you would pour out peace in this room right now. Unmistakable, supernatural, unhuman. It comes from you and gives us a confidence that our resources in Jesus Christ are completely adequate. And everything is according to your great grace and your great plan as we celebrate the memory of your dear servant, Alan Niquette. So we receive that from you. And now, Lord, would you pour out joy in remembrance. Give everyone freedom, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. My voice is a little bit screwy, but that's okay. Jenny, you want to come up and just share a little bit? We'll have a couple of family members share. And then I'm going to open this microphone. And don't be afraid. Alan loved the stage. And I'm going to ask you to come up here onto this stage. And with this microphone, share the joy of your heart. Would you do that? Okay, Jenny.
I guess probably 80% of you, if not more, have heard Dad reference his love for Walt Disney's quote about how every good screenplay should have laughter and tears. And that there are biblical parallels. I don't know the exact Bible verse, but I do know that we are to pray, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. So I'd like to give you a little piece of rejoicing and a little bit of weeping, but happy week. I'm going to start with the happy. For years, my dad has joked and told us stories, and in all of his stories, the little characters in his stories, ever since we were five, I mean really little kids, all of his funny little stories he'd tell us at bedtime, the characters never walked anywhere. They went just like that, every time. They did not walk anywhere. And on multiple occasions, he promised me that one day On this occasion, I would need to go and tell you guys that he has, in fact, doopy 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 doop 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 right into heaven. And just as a little bittersweet, tearful thing, you know, his ministry was so beautiful on stage, and it was so visible, and everybody took it to heart. And I just want to reassure you, behind the scenes, the beauty was just as real. And there were so many times, in particular, that when we'd get scared at night as little kids, he'd just come in the middle of the night, pick up his Bible, and sit down in a chair next to us and wait until we fell asleep and call it our midnight adventure. And I know that he continued to do that even after we moved out. Sometimes we'd come and say, "Dad, we just need you." And he'd come and, "Okay, I got my Bible, I'm coming." And I just want to reassure you all that I'm fairly certain that he's prayed for every single one of you at some point in depth and with extreme caring. And I love you guys. And he does too.
As you're coming, I just want to acknowledge my dear older brother, Paul Niquette, is in France. And I understand in some measure we're going to record it, either video or audio. And he's going to get in on this a little bit later on. His heart is so with us. He would like us to know of his goodwill and his comfort. Our biggest brother, 10 years older, an intellectual, powerful individual who has influenced the world tremendously. And now he's still an excellent writer and an excellent author. And he just simply wanted you to know that Alan was precious to him, that he called him a little Jiminy Cricket that sat on his shoulder. And Alan had lots of questions, technical questions for him, to which he said, "I'm so thankful that he would listen to the whole answer, even, and not never rebuke me for repeating myself." Okay, Beth, God bless you.
First of all, I want to say that Alan loved each and every one of you so much. You have no idea how much. That's just what I wanted to say, but I also have something really special here from my niece, Malaya, and I'm going to read this to you. "Dear Unky, I love you. I love you so much. You are a cool man. I love you so very much. Thanks for all your jokes." And I want you to know, I love you too, and our family loves you, and Alan loved you so much.
Thank you. Okay. Now this microphone is going to be open to you.
I met Alan when my daughter was 3, Alan and David, and my daughter would hide behind my skirt, and she'd want to see him, but she didn't want him to see her. Because he was bigger than life, you know? And so Alan was my pastor way back at Valley Bible, and then he was also my pastor at Bethel Baptist. And when they started DDM, my first husband, Tony, and I were there with them, and Tony was making the tent, and I think you guys are still using it. And I was making Alan's costume. And my son Alan, who was named after Alan, and his middle name is David, came in and he said, "Oh, I thought Dad was making the tent."
I first met Alan in 2009 at He Makes Me Laugh Clay. And it's funny that she used the term bigger than life, because that's what I was thinking of. Alan was just a big guy who was bigger than life. And we're happy that our family had the opportunity to know him. He's just really genuine and loving. And his wife's just as sweet and genuine.
That's exciting.
Alan was my dad's best friend. And our family has recently lost a very close loved one. And it was really hard to say goodbye to Alan, but I wanted to tell you that on October 28th, there was a fundraiser for my sister's family, and Alan came, and he came in his super handsome jacket, and I was in a big hurry to get home. And so I said, "Alan, looking good in the leathers," and turned around to leave. Well, you never just leave because it's of Alan. And so he followed me to the door, and he said, "Jennifer, I have to tell you the story about my leathers." And he proceeded to tell me about recently he had been to a military base and had driven right past the checkpoint because he was there to check out the base Beth laughs because she... so they, of course, hunt him down and pull him over, and they ask for his identification, and they say, "Sir, what are you doing on this base?" And Alan, being Alan, says, "Well, I'm just here to check it out." Which, when you're looking like Alan and wearing this leather hat and this leather jacket, that's probably not the best thing to say. So, of course, the one military officer steps back and has his hand on his weapon, and the other one is running his stuff. And he later is sharing the story with my dad, and my dad says, "You know, Alan, you were probably in the sights of someone's gun that whole time." And Alan looks at me and he says, "And that really humbles me, Jennifer, to think that we are all so close to heaven." And this was only just a couple of days before he went to be with his Lord. And I think, what a wonderful day when he entered heaven and met all of those characters that he spent his life portraying to us. Wow. I'm really lucky that many of you got to see that.
Thank you. That is so powerful. Dan, is this your daughter? Okay. Dan, I pray for you up here because my heart's been burdened for you in the loss of your grandson. You know why I know about that? My brother told me, weeping. We kept in touch. If you ever need somebody to call, I'll stand in for him if you need a word of prayer. Okay? Anybody else?
I'm one of the young men that Alan had an amazing influence on in his life, and I've known Alan for like probably 20 years or more, and I mean, his family is just a wonderful, you know, so many wonderful memories for me, and yeah, I'm just so thankful that I got to come here today and remember him, and I'm looking forward to seeing him in the future one day. One of my favorite representations that Alan played was Tevye. I still remember "If I Were a Rich Man." It's one of my favorite songs they ever sang.
I am Lina Ritaka from Hanson from Amity, and I didn't know the cats at all. And they came over and Alan said, "Well, what do you do here? I see all these cars going in and out of your driveway." And I said, "Well, we have VH repair. My husband is Dave Hanson. We have a car here in chainsaw business." And I said, "If you're not going to be gone too often on the weekend, when we travel, we have an alarm on our shop, but I'd really like you to notice." And he says, "Well, Myna, I can see your door to your business, even though it's got an alarm. If anybody tries to do that and set the alarm off," he said, "I'll call 911. And it was wonderful, because I always knew when they were home, Alan was scurrying around, Beth and the girls were out and everything, and our place was protected by Alan and his love of God. Thank you.
I'm Judy Becker. I'm Dan's wife, Jennifer's mother. We first met Alan and Beth when they did a play, one of the plays, and I believe it was He Makes Me Laugh, at Independence First Baptist. But Beth passed our house, I don't know, once and said, "That's my dream house." And I said, and Dan and I had to be out of town one time when they were coming in, and we had not met them yet. And so we just gave them the keys to our house and said, "Have at it. There's food in the refrigerator, it's yours." And Beth goes, "I get to stay in my dream house." 4 years later, we traded houses. And that's how Beth got her dream house. And Dan and Alan was there when we did prayer for my clinic when we opened it in June. So, and he came down and stole one of my filters from me. Actually, he talked me out of it, is what he did.
Noah, I was a good man. I'm Jerry James. I met Alan
Jerry.
And David and Patricia when we were at Bible together. And then Alan followed me at 12 Bible Church. And I went and spent 3 years in Alabama planting churches. When I came back to the Northwest, Alan and I got reacquainted. And that was during the time that he was dating Beth. I remember sitting in a restaurant listening to Alan and his excitement and everything. And I'd been married 10 years at the point in time and was just 100% behind the marriages. And just loved it. And so I had the privilege of, I want to say, walking through that period of time and then when he and Beth were married.
My name is Gary Anderson, and I was Alan's roommate back in 1980, and I was the one that got to introduce him to Beth. We had gone to a pizza parlor, I believe it was, and a bunch of folks from our church were there, and Alan turns to me and goes, "Who is that girl over there?" That's Beth the cat. He's like, "You've got to introduce me." So I got to introduce him, and as they say, the rest is history. But
yeah.
And then there's so many stories of Alan and I, it's really hard to pare them down. But one of my favorites was the first morning that I was renting from him. I'm asleep in bed, and the door opens up and Alan comes in singing, "Good morning to you, good morning to you." And I reached over to my nightstand and I picked up my pistol and I cocked it and aimed at the ceiling. And he shut the door, and it was the last time he ever entered my bedroom. But he was also very impetuous. July 4th, one year, he said, "Hey, let's just go up to Grand Coulee Dam and do, you know, just for the heck of it." So we jumped on our motorcycles and we rode up there, threw sleeping bags on the back, and had no idea where we were going to stay. And we get up there, it's 107 degrees at 7 p.m. in the evening. We find out that the state police up there are kicking the people off the side of the road that are trying to camp. There's no place to camp. And we find this little dirt road and pull back there, and here's this campground back there. And it was just like God had opened up. We pitched our tents and we were able to sleep there. But Alan and I had so much fun together in the, I don't know, year and a half before I married my wife, and Alan ended up marrying Beth. But he was a great roommate to have, and I just enjoyed the friendship that we shared together.
I know exactly how long I've known Alan. I was sort of charged of taking care of him as his doctor when he was in the area, which is not an easy task. He can be a stubborn guy, and I think Alan takes care of everyone and sort of tends to sort of take care of himself last. But before I came here, I kind of went through and was looking through my chart notes for the 16 plus years that I've known him. Chart notes tend to be kind of a bland and things, and one word kept coming up, and that was loquacious. And I don't typically throw that into a chart note, but Alan just kind of would talk and talk. And we sort of learned very early on that whatever he was coming in for, we tapped on an additional 15 minutes. Because he would pull out binders and show me photos of the latest productions they were doing and tell me what he was doing. The first thing, I would walk in the room, he would stand up and come over and shake my hand, and "How are you doing?" And I kept saying, "Alan, you got the roles wrong here. I'm supposed to be taking care of you. I'm getting paid to take care of you. You don't need to minister to me. This is my time to, you know, take care of you." But he never got it, and they would always go along, and he would talk and ask me, and he always ministered to me, and always, I loved it. It made me feel a little uncomfortable, because that really wasn't his job, but that was his job, you know, and so that's what he did. And I love this picture of him, because that's how he would come in with them. I love that leather hat that he would wear, and I miss the guy. So.
Thank you so much. One time I called him and said, how are you doing? And he said, "Well, I found out from my doctor that my low thyroxine causes a rate of oxidation to produce an exothermic goiter affecting over or secretion of tethylene in the pituitary gland. Would you explain that?
Yeah, I don't think I've raised it well.
Alan had an iron trap mine and all kinds of little chunks of stuff stuck up there. And some of it stuck in my mind as well. Okay, here we're going again.
My name's Caitlin Seaton, and Alan was my first pastor. When I was a little girl, I remember him at Bethel and always thinking that my pastor had the biggest voice of anyone I had ever met. Because everyone else, you know, would talk, you know, kind of quietly and politely, but every word out of Alan's mouth, you could hear it half the church. And so you always knew what he was talking about. But I remember, I'm going to go with the laughter and tears thing. There's only three things that you could, that Alan would talk about at length: his family, his ministry, and the Lord. Those were like the three subjects you could keep going with him, because otherwise you'd say something and he'd be like, oh, and keep going. And those, and all I can think of is Alan up in heaven with all of, you know, the all of the people he always played, and sitting there and sharing his stories with them at length and their reactions. And the biggest thing, Alan had a huge impact on me. My mom, Mary Seaton, was in the Ruth and Naomi place with them. And so she would go occasionally and I'd go with her and hang out with the girls, and, you know. But I kind of would feel left out because everybody had something to do with me. And so I was sitting shotgun for some reason when we were driving somewhere. I don't even remember how I got shotgun. But I told Alan, I was like, well, like, you know, I wish I could do something. And he's like, oh, well, no problem. And he just wrote me in. He made up a completely random character, this cheesed-off woman who was mad at one of the kids and came storming in, complaining about some prank they pulled on her. And he just literally just included me. He's like, sure, you want to be in it? Okay. And he just wrote it, driving there. And I'm just sitting there going, okay. And at the time, I had very little confidence in myself. And that just the fact that he just assumed that I'd be fine, that I'd be awesome, and that it was going to be great, and he was so excited. And that really affected me, that he really believed that I could do it, that, you know, as long as I was willing, that I would be fine. And even to this day, that just gave me that boost that if there was something I wanted to do, I could do it.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that.
I'm Julie, and Beth and I go way back to our early 20s. She used to drive a little black bug called Oglethorpe. That's what she called it. And I had a Chevy Vega, which I named the Silver Bullet because it's silver. Over the years, Alan, I've had the privilege of listening to Alan in a few sermons because he would be a guest pastor at our church. And I compare him to Martin Luther King, whereas you just couldn't walk away from his speech, especially in 1963, having not been affected. That's the way Alan was. I remember particularly once he said, take the time to get to know Jesus Christ personally. And another time he said, when I was at a very low point in my life, he said, it doesn't matter what you've done. God is there waiting for you. And let's see, need my glasses here, sorry. As DDM was growing, I was working as a television and film actress sometimes, and I had the honor of performing with DDM, which involved traveling with my small daughter and the Niquette family through different towns in Oregon and Washington. And we stayed in strangers' homes that were welcoming strangers, and we ate food that was set in front of us. Every time we drove away from an experience of performing with DDM, my heart was touched so deeply, and I felt more fulfilled than any part-empty feeling I felt after driving away from a highly paid film job that had a renowned chef catered meal.
My name's Ed, and I lived next to Alan in Tualatin, probably where you were his roommate. He had a motorcycle, and I see him in his letters, and I think that's that's where he should be. So when you're riding down the road, I ride a motorcycle now, think of Alan, think of the big guy behind the handlebars, cruising down the road, having a great time. I got an email the other day, and I don't know if you've heard of God Wings, but they're just little things that kind of pop out. Someone wrote something that says, old friends are like stars. You can't see them all the time, but you know they're there. And when you look up in the sky, think of Alan.
I remember with Alan and Beth, the thing that was different, I mean, we've been to different place before in that, but I know, like with Abraham and Sarah, the thing that was awesome about these plays were they were real. I mean, they really came alive. So much that you're right there, that you're right there, one of the people witnessing the event when they laughed, and of course, you know, had a child in that. And then one other thing that I wanted to mention too, real quick, I remember. A few years back, it's probably 5 or 6 years ago, going to a family reunion and you know, kind of quiet, and Alan came over, and we were talking that, and Alan came over, he liked to joke around a lot, and I'll never forget, he came over and he was laughing, he said, Dennis, how come you got so much gray hair? I got black hair, you got gray hair. Now I know the rest of the story, I guess he dyed it.
My name is Prentice Boyd. And I've known Alan and David since we were newlyweds in Northridge, California. And I was going to LA Baptist College, and I'd get out of college and go by Valley Bible Church and get my homework done because Alan and David were there and they could answer all my questions. When our daughter was born, she was 2 years old, and you know how pastors line up outside the door, shake everybody's hand? Well, I taught my daughter to say, Pastor David preaches, Pastor Alan preaches too. Too long. Then he taught my daughter to give her a tic tac. Well, and you repeat after me now. You tell your daddy, Daddy's an Okie. I came from Oklahoma, and anytime I would ever pull a joke on him, he would always get my daughter to say something right back. So anyway, there's so many things that we have done together over the years. I came to Multnomah in 1977, and one of my teachers was Dick Bohr that taught there, and he was telling me one day that they were looking for a pastor at Tualatin Bible Church. And I said, well, I know somebody that might be interested in coming up here. So I set up a meeting, and he interviewed there, and we stole Alan away from Valley Bible and his brother.
I remember Beth because she was the girl at church that had the Volkswagen Bug that had a dent on the fender, and she had painted a Band-Aid right over it. And now I remember the name of Oglethorpe. I remember after they started dating, I do not remember the moment that I met Alan, but I remember the topic, I think, that had to have happened somewhere around this first event. And he was just very excited to show me his gut bucket. Somehow or other, he found out that I played guitar and so forth. And we had some fun with that. And eventually, if you did go to their wedding, you'll remember that Alan came in after the wedding, and there was a little bluegrass number, and that was me on the banjo back then for that. So that was a great memory and a lot of fun. One other really little kind of funny event, just about the character of Alan. Really appreciate both Alan and Beth. Have meant a lot to me and my family, but this is a silly thing, so I don't know why I'm being emotional. Alan loved food. He loved to cook. He came over, they were at our house one night, and we were cooking something, and I think it must have been something Mexican. And one of the things about Alan, he just wasn't shy, right? If he thought something, he would just kind of say it. But he also would do it in a way that he didn't feel offended or anything, most of the time. Anyway, I was putting peppers, I put like a half a cup of green peppers in whatever this was, And it was coming out of this bag that I had chopped up and frozen and was in the freezer. And he was giving this expression, oh, more, more, more. But he didn't know I'd only put in the green ones. And so I put the green bag back, and he was disappointed I didn't put enough peppers in. But then I got out the bag of red peppers and another half a cup, and then the orange peppers. And I got his approval after that. So.
My name is Larry, and I met Beth and Alan at their very first venture with DDM. And to say that Alan is loquacious or that he brings people in just with his personality is a big understatement. He told me his vision, and I was hooked. At that point, I said that I was inviting him to our church, and I was going to support his ministry, and I was going to do whatever I could to help him. And from that day on, he just considered me a friend. And I got to be in his plays and do other things. But a lot of times he would just call up and say, I need you to come by. I want to talk about something. And he would just bounce ideas off. Many people have told stories about how he tricked them. He never put one over on me, but I had a blast putting one over on him that was long term. We're talking years, but his wife helped. I would come over and I would have a DDM support check, and I never mailed it. I would always bring it over, and she would come up and give me a hug, and I would palm the check to her. And then later, not right away, later, she would take it in and put it on his desk somewhere. And it was driving him nuts, trying to figure out, how did he get back there to put the check there? And I would come over, and he would be keeping an eye on me, just watching me. Trying to figure out how I got back into his room. Their cat really liked me. And the cat would come out, and I would hold it and talk to it. And so I kept telling him the cat was doing it. He didn't believe that. But he never caught on to how we did it. And it was great because, for once, the shoe was on the other foot. But he really played a big impact spiritually, emotionally, and just bringing me into his life. And Dan and I got to share it because we were partners in a business that didn't quite work out.
That's where I'll take over. I'm Dan of the Larry, Alan, and Dan LLC called LAD. We ended up buying a piece of property together and dreamed a lot about what we were going to do with it. As Larry said, it didn't work out well. We also had another partner come in with us, and that was my daughter, Danielle, who's over here with my third daughter. I have three of my daughters here today. The third daughter, Alyssa, was married by actually Larry and Alan as my brothers. And I always felt like they were that way. Alan was just like a brother to me before I met him. He told me he wanted to make our house his home, and we were going on, and it was fine. And he just became a brother to me. But I also gained out of that relationship, I gained a son, and that's Stetson. And Stetson and I spend a lot of time together underneath the house, but I think one of the things that reminds me and one of the best laughs I think Stetson and I had when we were trying to level the floor in this old house that was built back at the turn of the 18th to 19. And we were working, and Alan had to level up, and he was trying to get this one corner to raise up, and it just, more we jacked it, just wasn't going to go. So I got it as close, he said, that's about as good as we're going to get it. I asked him where he was at, and he said, well, I'm standing in this room, and I said, well, move over the doorway and let me look at it again. And so he moved over there, and I said, you're in the doorway? And he said, yeah. I said, well, everything looks pretty good to me down here, except I just need to get the dip out of the doorway. Took him a while to catch that one. He got it. And so we had our fun here, but we went up and we were doing the flooring up and upstairs. And he was, the walls came down and then it had about a foot and a half, 2 feet. And get back in on one of them. He was nailing the flooring down. And he was always worried about whether he had enough nails or not. He had his foot sticking out there. It was right in where I was nailing at. So I just put a nail through the toe of his shoe and I got into the floor. And he was there for 5 minutes before he realized he'd been nailed in place. So we had a good time and lots of laughter. Alan would always call me and said, "You got a minute to talk?" And I said, "Sure, Alan." For him, I always had a minute to talk. And he was real sensitive about my time. And, you know, as a brother, he fulfilled my life. He brought me a fulfillment that nobody else could. And I just admired him, his focus on things, his knowledge, and his well learned. But I have to tell you, the one final one that I really set him back was when my wife and I and Beth and Alan went to dinner. And, you know, we were sitting there at dinner, and I get over and give my wife a kiss after we prayed for dinner, and Alan looked over at me like this. Was, he just went bananas. He couldn't believe that. And so we got done, and he was still talking about it when we went out the door. And he was talking about there, and so when we went out the door, I reached over and I grabbed his hand. He couldn't talk. He could not talk. He couldn't say a word. But I will have fond memories of that and of Alan. And I'm looking forward to spending a lot of time with his son.
Stetson, you're a man of God, and you're the man of the house, and you don't have to do anything but just be yourself. You have the Lord so abundantly, such as everyone here has availability to. You have all you need, and I'm proud of you. Can we express our appreciation? My brother came out on my birthday here recently, and it was really precious. It was just 2 months ago, and it was so timely of the Lord that we could have all of our goodbyes. It was so sweet because brothers talking things of the Lord were really deep. Some of those deep things were done up way up on a mountain. I took them up 10,000 feet to Trap Lake, and I helped them limit out. I had great pictures of it. We saw moose, and none of them were as big as Alan, I'll tell you that. The moose backed off. That was a wonderful thing. And then as we came back to the parking lot, he said, "I'm going to do something I've been wanting to do all along. I want to build a memory, David. I want you to smoke a cigar with me." How many Baptists do we have here? Would you please close your ears right now? I came back later and talked to my elders. I said, I just smoked my first cigar. And I said, let me clarify that. I just smoked my last cigar. But we sat on the log up there and we began to talk about who we are in Christ. And we began to agree on language. And there was something so special about it. I can say that what I'm going to read next could come right from his lips on this occasion, right to your heart. He wants you to know who he is. For all of the things we talk about, all of that is who he is. But the secret, the underpinnings, I believe every one of us can relate to. So let me just read it, and then we will have the video. Celebrate my true identity. See if you can relate to this. I am a child of the living God. My Heavenly Father is the most high sovereign of the universe, above time, before all things, and ruler of eternity, and he knows me. He chose me He loves me. He always has. And he always will. His son, Jesus, is my friend. He is my king who has my love and my loyalty. He gives me identity and purpose. I am indwelt by the Holy Spirit of God, my strength, my advocate, who speaks God's truth to me faithfully. In him, I have all that I need to survive and to excel. I am secure forever in my identity as a child of this living, loving, triune God. Because Jesus died for me, conquered death for me, forgives me, and indwells me, therefore, Jesus defines me. I know who I am. And all that I am is a gift of his grace through simply believing and responding to his love. As God gives me the strength and grace, I will stand in this precious identity without fear, without compromise, with victory in life assured now and forever. Truly, I live and move and have my being in him. Thank you.
In all your ways, acknowledge him. In all your ways, seek to know him personally. And he will level the path and you will reach the very destiny for which you were created.
Father God, thank you for your presence here with us. Lord, I pray that you'll continue to fill this place with your presence by your Spirit, Father. And Father, as we open your word, we know that we can trust it to bring us peace, bring us strength, bring us victory. And Father, I pray the same prayer for the family. Give them the closure that they need today by this service. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 104 says, "Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise." Let's see if I can get this right. Al, doop-de-doop-de-doop-de-doop. Is that what he did? Into heaven's courts with praise and thanksgiving. He was welcomed by his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, accompanied by thousands of angels, along with the pillars of the faith, and all those who had gone before him. Introductions were made, and Al approached one man and said, "So, you're Paul." The man looked at him and said, "So, you're Al." You see, Al was intimately involved with God's Word. He and his wife founded Dramatic Differences Ministries, of which he was the director, producer, prolific playwright, and an actor. Why would a man do all that? Well, first of all, he loved and was committed to God the Father, who loved him first, gave himself for him. Al's talents and his abilities were God-given for the express purpose of use for God's glory and in his service. Al loved the family that God gave him. Dramatic Difference Ministries would serve as God's tool to involve the whole family in experiencing God's word and developing their own talents for acting, music, art, and the other things that the family is well known for, in order to serve God. Al's propensity for hard work, dedication, along with the provision of God-focused daily endeavors. That's kind of hard to chew, isn't it? And activity left a lasting legacy. I know the girls and Stetson talked about a legacy that Al left for the family. And all of us could take a page out of that book. But it doesn't stop there. Al loved people. He loved all people. He loved them fully and completely, as you know, and as you've heard today here. And he did it with a godly love. Mornings would find him at the coffee shop, spreading the gospel among the guys that came there to drink coffee. His desire was that all people would be able to see and to hear God's word, to have it come alive in order for God to make a dramatic difference in their lives. When they understood the message of salvation by God's grace through faith in Jesus Christ, and when they understood one of Al's favorite sayings, "He will forgive a lifetime of sin in one moment of faith if you simply believe." I've known Al and the family for, I think we figured 22 years. And all the time, Al's greatest desire was to present God's word by preaching or by drama. Al was an inspired preacher. Most of you knew that. He had unique insights in the presentation of the gospel message. That thing is gotta go. There's no question in any of our minds where Al is right now. He's in heaven. And I'm sure that when he walked in, and this has been said earlier, the Lord said, "Well done, good and faithful servant. It's an honor and a special privilege for me to present a message where we know where the deceased person is. It's truly a celebration of life, both because of a life beautifully lived and life is now being lived for eternity. You should be encouraged and refreshed because of it. However, I would be remiss if this message didn't come with a solemn warning. Did you notice that Al was suddenly gone? James 4:14 says, "What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes." Proverbs 21:27:1 says, "Do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day will bring forth." Of course, in Al's case, he was a Christian. He's in heaven. We know that. He's going to live forever in his heavenly home. What about you? Some of you are not Christians. I'm sure of that. And you have no excuse. You face eternal death. I'm sorry. But you don't have to. You see, Romans 10:9-10 says this, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God hath raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. John tells us that no one can say Jesus is Lord without the Spirit. As to the heart issue, Jeremiah 29:13 tells us that you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. Romans 10:10 goes on to say that it is with your heart you believed and are justified, and it is with your mouth you confess and are saved. I said Al's in heaven. He's there because he confessed Jesus is Lord and believed in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus is there because he came from there in the first place. He came to earth to reveal God in the flesh and to die for the sins of those in the world who would put their trust and faith in him for salvation. He then rose from the grave, descended into heaven to give you eternal life. And I know, and I can just see it happening now. If Al were here, he'd be clapping his hands and shouting, "Yes!" at the presentation of the gospel message. Al's there in heaven, waiting for us to show up. In the meantime, he has a role in the greatest drama ever presented. The heavenly drama unfolding before his eyes. And an example of that would be Revelation 6:11-14, where John says, "Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they sang, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and wealth and strength and honor and glory and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them singing, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever." The four living creatures said, "Amen." The elders fell down and worshiped. My prayer for the family, having had Al for a husband and a father, and having the knowledge that his life with them and with Dramatic Difference Ministries has positively affected hundreds of souls for Jesus Christ, and knowing where he is will encourage and strengthen them and bring them confidence and comfort for the future. May they and you go forth from this place in victory. Thank you.
On behalf of the family, I want to thank everyone who has shared today and come today. And we know where Alan is. Amen? We know what he's doing. He is worshiping the Lord, as was just described from the book of Revelation. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. The Bible says that we see Jesus face to face from that moment on. And that's what Alan is experiencing right now. And as he's worshiping there now, we can have a foretaste of that in our worship of the Lord today. 1 John says that we love him because he first loved us. And so I want to invite you to stand as we have a closing song, and then I believe Dax will come up and have a closing prayer for us. But would you stand? We want to worship the Lord and respond with our love to him, as Alan is doing today. May our love be even intensified by the reality that we know where Alan is, and if we know Jesus, we know we'll be there with him. And so let's worship him together with this song.
In moments like these, I sing out a song. I sing out a love song to Jesus. In moments like these, I lift up my hands. I lift up my hands to the
here at the church. It's been our honor to be part of this part of your life and this day. I've also been asked to give an invitation, and I would just ask you, I know that it's late, but for just a moment, would you remember the words I think that were quoted that were Alan's? It said, "Would you take a moment and get to know Jesus?" So before you leave this place, there'll be cookies in the foyer. There's coffee available. It won't be imposing upon anyone. If you would take a moment and say, "Would you talk to me about this Jesus? It's more important today than anything that you know without a doubt where you go beyond this life. And the gateway is Jesus Christ. He's paid for it all. All you have to do is accept that payment." Alan spent his life giving this message. It's the most important thing. So don't leave here today without considering it. It's not about religion or a preference or choice. Actually, it is about choice. It's about your choice. And what will you do with this knowledge? Alan's in heaven. We rejoice for him. We're excited for him. I'm jealous of him. but he wants you to be there with him someday. And there is a way, and the way is paid. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, so much for sending the Son to die for us, and Jesus, for laying down your life and then guaranteeing us and inspiring us and ensuring us by also giving us your Holy Spirit. God, I pray for those who are here that know this and are living this, that today would be a mark on their calendar where they would look back and say, I met with Jesus that day. I grew closer in my walk with Jesus that day during Alan Niquette's service and celebration of life. I opened up my heart in another way that day. And for those who don't know and haven't received or haven't trusted in Jesus as their Savior, that today would also be a mark on their calendar, that they would say, that was the day that I decided without any other issues clouding the issue that I would choose Jesus, that I would choose to believe in Jesus Christ as my Savior, that so that I could spend eternity with Jesus and also be united with Alan in that place. God, we pray that you would be at work in hearts as only you can. And Lord, that you would send us out with your peace, a peace that passes understanding from the Prince of Peace who gave it all for us. And God, just also a message or just a peace for the family. God, that you would speak to their hearts and encourage them, not only this day, but in the days moving forward in their life. Lord, we thank you for Alan, his testimony, his ministry. In Jesus' name, amen.